Please turn in Ephesians chapter 1. We're going to be here in the same passage that I preached in the last time here in Ephesians 1. We were in verses 3 through 6 2 weeks ago when I spoke, and this week we will be in verses 7 through 10. If you are able, please stand for the reading of God's Word. We're going to read from verse 3 onward through verse 10 because this is one complete thought. Verse 3, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. In love he predestined us for adoption as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace, with which he has blessed us in the beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us. In all wisdom and insight, making known to us the mystery of his will, according to his purpose, which he set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time, to unite all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth." Heavenly Father, again, I just pray that you would work in my heart and in the heart of every person here, that your Spirit might accompany your word and might make it effectual in our hearts, for we depend on you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Faith, would you be able to get me some water? I can tell I'm probably going to need it. If someone came to you who was an unbeliever, had no background in the Christian faith, and asked you this question, what would be your response? What happened when Jesus died on the cross? What happened when Jesus died on the cross? Again, this person has no background in Christianity, has never stepped foot in the church before. But this person says, "You believe in a man who lived 2,000 years ago. He lived the life of a common man. He died the death of a common criminal in that day. And somehow you believe that that death that he died was the pivotal moment in human history. That it is the purpose for which all creation exists. And you believe that. You have crosses on your jewelry. You have crosses, thank you, on your artwork. You have crosses in your pictures. Somehow you believe that that cross that Jesus died on was absolutely essential to your life, to the point where you center your life at this time and build it around that cross. Why? What happened when Jesus died on the cross? Such a question would clearly strike at the very heart of the Christian faith. It is the gospel. However, brothers and sisters, I fear that many of us in the church, in the pew, would not, in this country, be able to give a clear and concise response to that question. And that is why passages such as the one that we are looking at this morning in verses 7 through 10 of Ephesians 1 is so important, because it gives us a window, a picture, it opens the door to show us what was accomplished when Jesus died from God's perspective. Last time we were in Ephesians chapter 1, we looked at the work of the Father in Ephesians 1, verses 3 through 6. And we saw that Ephesians 1 as a whole is about the work of the Trinity in saving mankind. Man has fallen into sin. He is helpless in his fallenness. There is no way for him to save himself. And so God, Father, Son, and Spirit, has come into time and planned in eternity to redeem us, to save us, to bring us back to himself. And we saw that the Father, last time I spoke, does three things for us, and all of them took place in eternity past. He chose a people to be the recipients of his grace. He then pronounced over them everything that they would receive in Jesus Christ by faith. And then he also predestined them to become his children. This week we look at God the Son, the second person of the Trinity, and his role in our salvation. Last week, or the other week, we looked at salvation planned by God in eternity past. This week we look at salvation accomplished by Jesus Christ. The second person of the Trinity, Jesus Christ, comes into the world and he accomplishes everything necessary for that people that God the Father chose to be the recipients of his grace to receive those blessings. He is the foundation of everything that you and I have received in Christ. Literally, the reason you are sitting in your seat this morning. If you are here, you are here because you profess to have been saved by the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that is because he accomplished a work on the cross. And he accomplished a work on the cross because God the Father decided that man would be saved. And that's what we are looking at here. Now, everything we see in verses 7 through 10 that talks about God the Son and what he has done for us is wrapped around one single concept. And that concept is the concept of redemption. Redemption. When we're asked the question, what happened when Jesus died on the cross? Paul's answer in verse 7 is redemption happened on the cross. And I'm going to be honest with you, we're not going to cover all of verses 7 through 10. We're actually only going to study this morning verse 7 and the beginning of verse 8. And as I have opportunity to come back, as the Lord wills, we will continue in verse 8 to verse 10. But let's read here verse 7 and the beginning of verse 8 so that we have a context to go on as to what we will be studying today. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace which he lavished upon us. That is one complete thought. And that's what we're going to be unpacking today. There are four things that I want us to get from this text, okay? So this is our overview of what we're going to be covering. Four things. Christ's redemption is defined by Old Testament history, number one. Number two, Christ's redemption is founded on the shedding of blood. Number three, Christ's redemption accomplishes the forgiveness of sins. And lastly, Christ's redemption comes from the free grace of God. These all rise up out of this short passage, and they are full of truth. As we sit today, let us have reverence over this text, because in this passage, we find the only hope for our souls in these four points that come out of this text. Let's begin here. First point, Christ's redemption is defined by Old Testament history. The main thing I want us to get as we look at this first point is that when we see a person in the New Testament use the term redemption, they are using a term that has its foundation and its context in the Old Testament. They're not pulling a term out of the air. When you see someone use that term, that is an Old Testament term. It has its beginning in the Old Testament, and it has a very rich definition there. So if we don't know our Old Testament, we will not rightly understand many terms in the New Testament, and thus our understanding of what Christ even accomplishes, as we see here in the term redemption, will be faulty. I'll confess that for a long time I had the same problem. For a long time in my Christian walk, I had a concept of redemption that was very vague when I saw that word. But when I actually studied and understood what the word meant, it became clearer to me, and I realized that in its entirety, what I thought redemption meant was incorrect. And so we have to go to the Old Testament to understand it. Now, when we go to the Old Testament to define the term redemption, there are two primary definitions that arise. We're going to go through each of those two definitions, and then with each of them, we're going to look at what they mean for our individual lives. What it means that we are redeemed in light of that definition. Now first, redemption is the payment of a ransom or a sum of money to set someone free from punishment or to pay a debt. The term redemption as a Jew in first century culture would be the payment of a ransom or of a sum of money to set someone free from punishment or to pay a debt. Here's some examples we have from the Old Testament of this. In Leviticus chapter 25, verses 47 through 49, if someone owed a debt to someone else and they couldn't pay it, they were able to sell themselves into slavery to that person they owed money to for a set period of time to work off that money they owed. But if they came into money, or their family and friends wanted to set them free from that sentence of slavery, that money could be paid to the person that they were working for, and that person could then be redeemed from the necessity of slavery, from that sentence of slavery. And at that moment, that person would be considered redeemed. An amount of money had been paid so that they could be set free from their slavery. Now, second example, Exodus 21, 29 through 30. If a person owned an animal, in this text what it says is that if a person owns an animal that's known to be violent, and it's just everyone in the society, in the town knows this animal is dangerous, and he doesn't do anything about it, and it ends up killing somebody, that person was to be put to death. But the family of the person who died was to negotiate an amount of money. And if that man was able to come up with the amount of money that was negotiated, then he could redeem his own life from the penalty of death. That person would not have to go and die and be stoned. And so he would be considered redeemed at that time, redeemed from capital punishment. So there again, there are many examples of this in the Old Testament law. But it's just important that we get the foundational concept. It's paying an amount of money so that a person does not have to live out a sentence of some kind. Now, applying this to our individual lives, if it says that in Jesus we have redemption, and that means paying an amount of money to take care of a debt for someone else, that means for you and I, listen to this, the penalty of sin is like a debt that we owe to God. The penalty of sin is like a debt that we owe to God. That is the debt that we owe that the Lord Jesus Christ took care of. The debt of our sin, of our guilt, of the penalty of our sin that we justly deserve. There are plenty of examples, again, in the New Testament other than just the concept of redemption. Luke 7, 41 through 43 is the parable of the debtors. And in that parable, it's clear that the debts that these people owed were sin. Jesus is purposefully making the illustration of debt to describe our sin. Colossians 2, verse 14 is a very important text in understanding this. Paul says that Jesus Christ in his cross, in his death, removed the certificate of debt that stood against us. He's describing sin and Jesus Christ taking care of our sin, but he says that that is the certificate of debt. Again, making a clear connection to the concept of debt. The reason Scripture makes that illustration between sin and owing a debt is because when we sin as unbelievers in our lives, or when we continue unrepentantly in our sin, it is the accumulation of guilt, the accumulation of God's judgment that we deserve before Him. We are accumulating God's wrath, and we see that even in the book of Romans, in the beginning of the book, he says that we are storing up wrath against the day of wrath, against the day of judgment. Paul says that about you and I, apart from Christ. Think about that. What sins did you and I commit last week? This past week, between Sunday and Sunday? If we are not in Christ, and if we have not rested on Him, then those sins are accumulating guilt. They are accumulating God's wrath against us. It is building and building. Jonathan Edwards, in his sermon, Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God, used an illustration of this accumulation of God's wrath against us over time. But he used a different illustration than debt. He used the illustration of waters behind a dam that are building and building and growing stronger. Listen to what he has to say here. The wrath of God is like great waters that are dammed for the present. They increase more and more and rise higher and higher, till an outlet is given. And the longer the stream is stopped, the more rapid and mighty is its course when once it is let loose. 'Tis true that judgment against your evil works has not been executed hitherto. The floods of God's vengeance have been withheld. But your guilt in the meantime is constantly increasing, and you are every day treasuring up more wrath. The waters are continually rising and waxing more and more mighty. And there is nothing but the mere pleasure of God that holds the waters back, that are unwilling to be stopped and press hard to go forward. If God should only withdraw His hand from the floodgate, it would immediately fly open, and the fiery floods of the fierceness and wrath of God would rush forth with inconceivable fury, and would come upon you with omnipotent power. And if your strength were 10,000 times greater than it is, yea, 10,000 times greater than the strength of the stoutest, sturdiest devil in hell, it would be nothing to withstand or endure it. What we need to take away from this is we need to remember, you who are living in unrepentant sin, if you or I are living in sin, accepting it, entertaining it, playing with it, know that your actions are not without consequences. They have consequences as God has ordained in this life, but especially in the one to come. And there are men in American history who have gotten away with wrongdoing. They have died and gone into eternity and never saw the consequences, never been caught in life. But it matters not, because the great judge knows, and that guilt is accumulating and building. Brothers and sisters, let us consider how desperately we need the redemption spoken of in verse 7. In Him we have redemption. The second definition of the word redemption in the Old Testament is that redemption means deliverance from slavery, the general concept of deliverance or being set free from slavery. The other one was the payment of an amount of money to set someone free from something, but this is just generally deliverance from slavery in particular. The best example we have of this is when the nation of Israel came up out of Egypt. It was out of the land of slavery, and they went into the desert and ultimately the promised land, into God's the land of Canaan. Now, in many passages in the Old Testament, God calls Himself their Redeemer because He brought them up out of that slavery. And even in Paul's mind, I would argue, this would be the primary way that he meant the term redemption in verse 7. Because to a Jew, this was integral in their identity. 2 Samuel 7, 22-24, God says that He is their Redeemer who brought them up out of Egypt. Isaiah 48:17, Jeremiah 50:33-34, Isaiah 49:7, and on and on and on. God calls Himself the Redeemer of Israel. And throughout the New Testament, we actually see that in many passages that process of Israel coming up out of Egypt, going through the wilderness and into the Promised Land, is foreshadowed in our Christian life. As Israel went up out of Egypt, we come up out of the slavery of our sin. And as they go through the wilderness wanderings, we go through our own type of wilderness wanderings as we live on this earth. We are on our way to the eternal state, and we fall into sin, and we struggle. Things are not perfect. If anyone is a member of any church, they know Christians are not perfect. And they struggle and they fall. But all of us who are God's end up in that promised land. Now, applying this concept of the deliverance of slavery to our individual lives, the power of sin is like slavery. The power of sin is like slavery. Like we said before, the penalty of sin is like a debt that we owe to God. The power of sin in your daily practical life is like slavery. Again, plenty of New Testament evidence. Titus 3:3 says that we are enslaved to our various passions and pleasures. Romans 6 verse 16 takes it another step farther and says that we are either slaves to sin or slaves to God. John 8:34 says, the one who sins is a slave to sin. Jesus said that. Ephesians chapter 2, 1 and 3. Just one chapter from where we're studying, Paul says that we are dead in sin, and we are by nature children of wrath. The basic idea of being enslaved to sin is that you and I, by nature, are not neutral in our decision to follow God. Apart from God's direct intervention in your life and mine, we will always choose sin. We will always choose selfishness. We will always go astray. And have you ever seen anything else in your own life? I know that in my life, if I choose what normally, apart from God, if I depart from the Scriptures, if I'm distancing myself from God, what happens? I certainly do not act as if I'm free to follow Him. I plunge myself into my own selfishness. I seek my own wants. My family suffers. I suffer. Everything in my life becomes broken because I am enslaved to sin. And that is what we all are. There's a lot of talk today, brothers and sisters, about the slavery that the USA took part in. in times past, and it was truly terrible. But brothers and sisters, everyone on this earth is born into slavery. And it is a slavery that knows no race, no creed, and no nationality. I would invite you to consider for a moment the awful slave master that rules over us. More men's lives have tragically ended in brutal death under this slave master than any other. More marriages have been shattered and torn into pieces by this slave master. More children have departed from their parents and households ruined by this slave master than by any other. Hopes, dreams, and bright futures have ended in grief and heartache under this cruel tyranny. Whole civilizations have crumbled and gone into oblivion. And all that we can see of them today are archaeological ruins because of this slave master. And that slave master is sin. Dear brothers and sisters, if you are tempted to live in sin and pursue the desires of your flesh, do not be fooled by the belief that you can stop any time that you like or that it will be one harmless experience. Look at the example of history. It will destroy you. It will drive a wedge in your marriage, hurt your children, hinder relationships and accountability. It will lead to your own destruction. And it will be better for you if you had an Egyptian whipping your back, torturing you with starvation and dehydration, and forcing you to make bricks in the scorching sun, than it would be for you to live in your sin. And that, slavery. Look and see, brothers and sisters, how desperately we need this redemption that is in our text. In Him, we have redemption. Now, second point in our message this morning. Christ's redemption is founded on the shedding of blood. Christ's redemption is founded on the shedding of blood. When Israel came up out of the land of Egypt, out of that deliverance, that redemption that they received, it was founded on the shedding of blood. For those who were not delivered in Egypt, it was the shedding of their firstborn son. For those who were delivered, God offered a substitute, a spotless lamb that could be slaughtered so that they would not have to have their firstborn son killed. In the same way, the eternal redemption that God has accomplished in Jesus Christ, that those things foreshadowed are founded on the shedding of blood. It is the shedding of the blood of God's only Son. And it is the shedding of the blood of the perfect and spotless Lamb of God. The substitute that stood in our place, taking the judgment that we deserved, removing from us our sin. And in that shedding of the blood of the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world and God's only Son, in the death of Christ on the cross, He removed the penalty of guilt that we had before God. And He also broke the chains of slavery to sin. Both fell to the earth and shattered under Christ, under His salvation. That penalty of guilt that was accumulating against us was completely removed in Him. And the slavery to sin has been taken care of. Because the penalty of guilt has been taken care of, you can have an intimate relationship with God, a personal relationship with God. That wrath is not accumulating against you anymore. God is not becoming more and more and more and more angry with you every moment anymore because of the cross. And because of the cross, the chains of slavery to sin have been broken, and you are now able, if you are in Christ, to choose between God and sin. You are not enslaved to choose sin and selfishness in your life. As Paul said, "Oh, the depths of the riches of the knowledge of God. How unsearchable his ways. He's removed these two great enemies from us. And that is what redemption means. Redemption means that the penalty's been paid for, that the slavery's, you've been delivered from your slavery. Now, third point. Christ's redemption accomplishes the forgiveness of sins. Christ's redemption accomplishes the forgiveness of sins. In him we have redemption. Through his blood, that's our second point, the forgiveness of our trespasses. Note this, brothers and sisters. When God the Father chose to save humanity, he planned that way of salvation, and he sent Jesus Christ into the world to accomplish that salvation. He did not do so through social change. He did not do so through political reform. He did not do so through even helping the needy or through community. He did so through the forgiveness of sins. And in the same way, the scriptures as a whole drive toward this one point. According to the scriptures, your problem is sin, and all other problems stem out of that. And the solution to your sin is the forgiveness of sins, is forgiveness. It identifies the redemption that Christ accomplished with that. And in so doing, our lives and our churches must make the forgiveness of sins our great goal and use whatever God has appointed to bring that about, to drive for it. We're going to look at both of those as churches and as individuals. As churches, we need to keep the main thing, the main thing. As I said a moment ago, there are plenty of sidetracks available for you. As a whole, as a church, to be your focus. You got the concept of community, of evangelism, of political action, being involved in the society, of helping others. These are good things. These are part of God's plan. But the farther we get in making those things our main thing, the farther away we get from Scripture's main thing. We have to make the forgiveness of sins and the redemption of Jesus Christ our focus and our what we make the center of our churches. And everything else flows out of that. It's a part of that. We will get to all the other things. But it is too common for us to miss the cross for what the cross does in implication. Now, as individuals, we need to fervently pursue the forgiveness of sins. If the scriptures again tell you that your problem, your main problem, is sin, that the remedy of that main problem is your forgiveness of sins, that the penalty and the power of sin is broken in the forgiveness of sins in Christ. If that is true, how much time do you and I spend seeking the forgiveness of sins as it is revealed in the Scriptures? Jesus said in Matthew 11:12, "From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven has suffered violence, and the violent take it by force." Salvation is all of grace, and it is by faith alone, so it's not by our works. However, it does take a lot of effort. It takes effort because there's all kinds of things that vie for our attention and for our allegiance. Your money, your goals, your, you know, keeping up with the Joneses, everything, and even biblical things, biblical studies, biblical, you know, anything under the sun vies for the attention instead of the salvation that Christ has accomplished in Jesus Christ. If we really believe that everything is centered in the forgiveness of sins found in the cross, we will live in a very specific way. We will order our lives in a very specific way. We must strive and work. Jesus said that it is violence. No one makes it to the kingdom of heaven but by violence, effort, and hard work. Now, finally, fourth point. Christ's redemption comes from the free grace of God. Now, this, all eyes up here. This is where it gets good. This last point. Christ's redemption comes from the free grace of God. In Him we have redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of His grace, which He lavished upon us. The word grace, whenever we hear that word, we're taught to always hear unmerited favor. It's God's unmerited favor, and that is true. That's true. But the word favor in our American understanding isn't quite as forceful as the word grace in Greek. The word that is used there is the word charis, which we get the word charity from. And here's the definition. Listen to this. This is the definition of the word grace that He has riches toward us of. That which affords joy, pleasure, delight, sweetness, charm, loveliness. The word lavish, that's found in which He says He lavished His grace upon us. Abundant, exceedingly, more than is needed. That's the definition there. Do you hear what this is saying? Christ came and redeemed us because God, number one, first point, there's two things I want us to hear here. Christ came and redeemed us because God takes pleasure in and rejoices over those who believe in Christ. God takes pleasure in, He delights in, and rejoices over those who believe in Christ. Do you see the difference between the concept of God rejoicing over somebody, taking pleasure in somebody, and having favor in somebody? There's a slight difference in the way we hear it. You could rightly say that in Christ, God enjoys you. He loves you. He has favor for you. He delights in you. That's an awful a lot different from storing up wrath against the day of wrath, storing up God's anger against us, right? Well, what happened when Jesus died on the cross? That. Instead of storing up God's anger against you, God delights in you. He likes you. He enjoys you. That's what Christ accomplished on the cross. Not only that, second point, God takes pleasure in us more than we could ever imagine. He lavished His grace upon us, abundant, exceedingly, more than is needed. That means He heaped His joy and His pleasure on us. He says it's the riches of His grace. Have you ever used this expression about somebody? So-and-so has more money than they know what to do with. Ever use that? Like, just go out and buy a car, RV, another house. Has more money than they know what to do with. They can never spend all the money they have in their lifetime. You can rightly interpret this passage by saying that you have more joy, pleasure, love, and favor from God than you know what to do with. Than you could ever plunge to the depths of. Than you could ever begin to understand. Do not be fooled, brothers and sisters. There is a tendency in our Christian lives and sometimes behind the pulpits of our churches that as Christians, we are supposed to feel this terrible shame when we sin, and we should be broken about our sin. But there's this picture of God tapping His foot up in heaven with His arms folded, and He's waiting for you to come and just confess and make it all right again. That is not the God that is in Scripture. If you are in Christ, if you have believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, He wants you to confess, He wants you to grow, and He will sometimes bring temporal punishments into your life for you to grow. But as a father, He takes pleasure in you. He delights in you. He likes you if you're in Christ. The only thing that you have to thank for that is the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ. Not yourself. We're not likable actually to God, but it's the cross. And so I ask you, what happened when Jesus died on the cross? What happened when Jesus died on the cross? He redeemed us from the penalty and power of our sin. He won God's forgiveness for us. And it was the greatest demonstration of the grace of God that we could ever have. Because of Him, slavery is turned into freedom, guilt into grace, and the wrath of God turned into pure delight. As a final application today, I'd like to look at Psalm 46. You can turn there, maybe on the screen. Psalm 46, we're going to read the whole psalm. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God will help her when morning dawns. The nations rage, the kingdoms totter. He utters His voice, the earth melts. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come, behold the works of the Lord, how He has brought desolations on the earth. He has made war cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the chariots with fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. What it means for us that God takes pleasure in us because of Jesus Christ is that in every circumstance, you have no reason to run from God as from a judge who stands ready to punish. You have no reason to hide from Him, but instead to run to Him, to make Him your fortress and your refuge, to depend on Him. And when it seems as though the earth is crumbling down around you, He's your North Star. He will never change. His love will never change. His character will never change. His faithfulness to you will never, ever change. Let's close our eyes and bow our heads for a moment. I'm not going to make anyone raise their hands or anything. There's nothing wrong with that, but I want us to take a moment and just confess any sins that you might need to reveal to God. You know, the best motivator to revealing our sins and coming in transparency to the Lord is that He loves you and He's not going to change because His love is founded on Christ. Think over the past week if there is anything that you need to make your relationship with God, at least on a practical level, mended. Take away anything that's in between you and Him in your heart. Do so. Because He loves you. And He promises to take you. If you take one step toward Him in repenting, confessing your sins to Him, He'll run the rest of the way. That's what the prodigal son did. And that's what He promises to all of us. Well, let's do that, and then I'm going to close that in a prayer, and then I'm going to share a scripture for us, and we will worship. Father, we thank you that you are not like us. You don't change like the wind. You do not change your commitments. You don't fumble on your faithfulness as we do. You are so good, and your attributes, your character never changes. You're eternal in your love for us. We thank you. We thank you for who you are. Lord, I pray that you might have mercy on us, because even though you have demonstrated your love for us in the redemption that you've accomplished in Christ, we still sin. And that sin hurts you, because you are our Father. Even though your love toward us never lessons, you are hurt, and you desire that we might grow in Christ-likeness, and you will ensure that we do. I pray that you might help us all to be more like this great Savior in his loveliness. Thank you that he's redeemed us from the penalty of sin and the power of sin. Thank you that he is working in our lives, and that he will see us through. Pray that you might help us in this coming week to depend on your promises and your love, to trust in you with all that we are, and not in our works, because we will fail ourselves, others will fail us. You never fail us. In Jesus' name, amen. If you confess your sin to the Lord Jesus today, if you lay your sins down at the foot of the cross, at the throne of grace this morning, hear this word from 2 Corinthians 5:17 through 18. This is true about you. He promises this on the basis of his word. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, new has come. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself. Let's sing and worship, because you have that new life in Christ. You can live to the worship and joy in God that you're called to because of him. Let's worship because, like, we know that. Thank you.